I want me some glory hole.
Oh yeah. Hello, boys and girls, and welcome to the Football Glory Hall Podcast. Whether you listen on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spreaker, SoundCloud, YouTube, or on iHeartRadio, we thank each and every Glory Hall seeker for tuning in this week. I'm your boy Bo Stevens, and I'm here, as always, with my boy Longhorn. And Longhorn, it is draft week. This is the draft podcast recap of round one. You've done some excellent work of And kudos to you, sir. Kudos to you so far through this process.
Yeah, and thank you for knowing that, sir. I appreciate you always for recognizing all the fantastic things that I do. Yeah, it's been fun. We had the draft last night, first round, and it was interesting. Some things that happened that were expected, some things that happened that were not expected, and we'll go over a few of those here and then kind of look forward to today's second day of the draft and see how that's going to all unfold.
Yep, it's going to be day two today. We probably will be out and about again tonight. Don't know quite where yet, but we'll let you know. But this podcast will be out before the day two festivities start.
And beer on Bo Cephas, as always.
As always, as we are here poolside enjoying a fucking cigar and some beers there, kid.
Holbert.
But let's get into the first round. Last night, there was definitely some marked differences from years past. The quarterbacks, obviously the biggest story, or lack thereof story, that there was only one drafted, and he was drafted the latest we've had one drafted this entire millennium.
Oh.
So that was a story. But let's just start who was taken. Number one overall, Trayvon Walker. Now, you did a great job of the write-up on him and talking about on your mock podcast on the Football and Freedom. By the way, if you haven't checked that out, check that podcast out. Football and Freedom, my boy Longhorn here. That's on the Revolution. We are now on the Revolution Network. You boys are moving up in the world.
Join the Revolution.
That's right. But I saw something on this today on the PFF grade. So basically the last eight first round, number one overall picks, their PFF grade in college, the year they came out, I think the lowest one was like a 90.4. And Trayvon Walker's grade last year was a 70.4 or 70.4, some crazy shit like that. It was so far low and below what the previous seven have been.
Right.
Now, again, if the people haven't listened, go ahead and tell them your synopsis of the player, and then what did you make of, you know, kind of taking that big leap?
Well, yeah, and I guess it's better just take it with the top two players and kind of package them together, because that was basically the decision that they had to make. And with Trayvon Walker, basically what Jacksonville decided to do was to swing for the fences and try to hit the home run, which honestly, you know, I personally wouldn't have done that. I would have gone with Hutch or a different player. But when you're Jacksonville, you're not a good team. I can't fault them for trying to hit the home run. Now, on the flip side of that, you can definitely argue that when you have a young franchise quarterback going to his second year, you need to do whatever you can to surround him with the help he needs. Not that defense doesn't help your overall team, but it's not necessarily going to help your quarterback on the field. And without the quarterback developing and becoming comfortable in an offense, it's what does it matter what you have on defense? So it's kind of splitting the baby. I understand the pick and the huge, huge monster upside that Trayvon Walker has, but you know, it's one of the things that I was going to talk about here is like the Jags and the Packers. You know, those are two teams that came into this draft really needed to focus on helping their quarterbacks. It's interesting that one is a like 40-year-old and the other one's like a 20-year-old, but you know, in different veins, they both needed help though. And the Jags took two defensive players and the Packers took two defensive players.
Well, I mean, in fairness, Jacksonville's obviously one of those stalwart franchises that, I mean, they always knock it out of the park, right? I mean, how many Super Bowl trophies are in their case? I mean, how many more championships do they have to win to prove to you that they know what the fuck they're doing.
Okay? I probably just one. Just one will do it.
Oh, man. Yeah, poverty franchises are poverty franchises for a reason.
I mean, what do you think? Like, the fact that they had two picks in the first round and didn't help the quarterback. I mean, isn't...
That's tough. I guess with the only thing that their thought process is they invested money on the offensive side of free agency, right? They picked up the all-pro guard. Mm-hmm. They picked up, you know, a good slot receiver, paid him $100 million or whatever the fuck they paid him. Crazy amount. So I guess what Balky's doing down there is investing money on the offensive side and draft assets on the defensive side. We'll see, man. I mean, you know, Balky's got people that are fans and people that are not, but I will remind everyone, he was the architect behind that great San Francisco run back when it was between Alex Smith and Kaepernick. Mm-hmm. And Coach fucking Khakis was there, and they went to, I think it was like 3 out of the 4 years their NFC Championship game and went to a Super Bowl. So
yeah, we'll talk about this whole list of first round players, and we'll have players that we really like. We'll have players that we poo poo and shit on, but we'll talk about value. We'll talk about things like, oh, you could have got him later, or that's a reach here and there. But at the end of the day, on the football field, when the pads start popping, where you drafted a player goes out the window, and it becomes, is he fucking good or not? So, you know, and like you said, Balky's got a track record. Who am I to say that you're stupid? It just isn't what I would have personally done.
Okay. So, one, they went for the home run. Two, Detroit, your boy, the kneecappers there, they went for the double, right? They went for the triple, single double. Up middle. Double. I mean,
single. You're only saying that because he's white. You're racist.
Now I'm more saying it because, you know, the Bosa comparisons has come up with, you know, Aiden Hutchinson, which, again, because he's a white guy, and I'm sure it's because they're white or whatever.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
But everybody that said that, and then all the guys that actually, you know, dig into this stuff, yourself included, all y'all said, yeah, not quite. Like, yeah, he's white and he's kind of big, but he ain't the Bosa boys. So,
yeah, and that narrative, obviously, for people like me who've been following, we've been saying that for a month or two. And you know how these narratives build. Like, once a narrative sticks for that long and it kind of gets a player's narrative starts going one way, it kind of gets carried away too far. So, yes, he's not Bosa, but when a narrative like that builds for a couple months, it starts becoming like, ah, well, he's not a Bosa. He's no good. That's not true. Like, he tested on a very high elite level, just not the most elite, like a Walker or the Bosa brothers, or like a, you know, like a Clowney or a Myles Garrett, but he's right there under him. It's not like he's doo-doo. So, you know, I think it took the Lions about 2.5 seconds to run the card up after Walker was picked. That pick was in immediately. After that, this is the player that they really wanted. So, and speaking of that, Detroit, like, they're continuing the building process. We talk about it on FGH all the time. They're one of my adopted teams. I like the teams that build through the draft and start and doing it the right way. And I was very scared coming into this draft that they were going to shit the bed and take like a Malik Willis or a, heaven forbid, Pickett, who we'll talk about later, and kind of derail this rebuild process, because don't forget, they got two first round picks next year. They've got a handful of picks coming up today and tomorrow. And in the second pick of the first round, they took Jameson Williams, wide receiver out of Alabama, to go along with what they're already building on offense, which is when you look at their offense on paper and you throw out Goff, offensive line, one of the best grading offensive lines in the league. And then now with the skill positions, they brought in DJ Chark. They got Jameson Williams now. Amon St. Brown came on last year. They got DJ Swift. That's right. DJ Swift. It is DJ Swift, right?
Yes.
Is that the right message? Yeah. And then Hawkinson. So, my God, like, they're loaded on offense. And you know, we'll see what they do today with the picks they have today. But I like what Detroit's doing. I'm happy they didn't derail it by taking Malik Willis at number two. So thank God for that.
Don't ever underestimate the anonymous St. Brown, or even the unanimous St. Brown, the St. Brown boys. Mm-hmm. They're They're something. They really are something.
That's two people know what you're talking about, but they're right here.
We're all sitting right here.
Yeah.
All right. So moving on past that.
Yeah, we don't have to go pick for pick. Like, if you see a player that you know, kind of so, want to point out.
Yeah, I want to talk about my boy for just a second. For sure, four, the New York Jets. They did something really smart, and they took who, in my estimation, is the best cornerback in the draft. Probably maybe end up being one of the best players overall in this draft. Mm-hmm. And I think they really knocked it out of the park with that pick. Mm-hmm. And, you know, some people say Stingley was going to be better, and who knows, whatever, if he will, won't, whatever. But I think Gardner is got the upside and the safe pick at the same time. Like, he was just a home run prospect to me for everything you said on your mock draft podcast. It's on the field, right? He never gave up a touchdown. He makes no mistakes. Nick Saban, Alabama, wanted zero part of him. They did not want to throw the ball at him all. If you guys know any of our clients, you know you hit the first half under on that. And part of my handicap was, I said it on the podcast, Alabama was not going to even try to throw the football. They're just going to run against that soft, Cincy middle and keep their young quarterback out of any kind of trouble. They were not going to challenge Sauce in any sort of way at all, and they didn't at any part of that game. And not only that, but off the field, I mean, there's nothing but great reviews about this kid. There's nothing but great reviews about him in the locker room as a leader, as a person, as a man. Mm-hmm. Everything checks out. So either he's, you know, got us all fooled, or he's one of the cleanest prospects that we've seen at any position in a long fucking time. And I love this kid to death.
Yeah, he's clean. There's nothing you can ding him with at all, for sure, on the field or off, like you said. It's, you know, the ball skills, though, might be, if I was going to push back, which, you know, I'm not going to fight you on it. Absolutely.
I mean, you do know more about the ball skills than I do. That's for sure.
I mean, I am. I've been known to have my balls played with. Let's put it that way. But that's the only thing I can push back on. I'm not going to get in an argument about Sauce Gardner over Derek Stingley. But if I was forced to, like, just put a distinction between the two, it would simply be the ball skills. And that's it. I mean, again, you're just pinching hairs at that point. The one thing I did want to note with the Jets and the Giants, two teams that both had two picks in the first round, it's interesting that the way that they both went. The Jets went with help on the outside with Sauce Gardner on defense, and then they took Garrett Wilson, wide receiver, Ohio State, for the offense, while the Giants, also two picks, they beefed up on the lines, taking Kayvon Thibodeau at 5, defensive end from Oregon, and Evan Neal, the huge, massive mountain of a man from Alabama, on the offensive line. So it's just kind of interesting that those two teams in need with two picks, one went outside, one went inside. We'll see how that works out.
Yeah, we'll see. If I had to guess, the Jets are still going to suck because of the Jets and their poverty franchise as well. And the Giants generally get their shit together about once every 6 or 7 years.
Mm-hmm.
So this could be the start of that. I wanted to move on to the other big topic in the first round that became a topic, was the run on wide receivers. And the amount, I think they said it was a 6th draft in the first round. It's the most we've had, I think, since 2010 or something. I don't remember. I heard something about that. But it was a lot of wide receivers, and I didn't think that the best ones were selected first. But who was your number one wide receiver on your board, and where did he go? And who do you think made the biggest fuck-up in their wide receiver selection?
Okay, several questions there.
Lots to unpack, boys.
So from 8 to 18, six wide receivers taken. Now, to your questions, my God, you know, a lot of this has to do with fit and where they land, because honestly, from 8 to 18, let me just name the receivers: Drake London, USC, Garrett Wilson, Ohio State, Chris Olave, Ohio State, Jameson Williams, Alabama, Jahan Dotson, Penn State, kind of a surprise there to the Washington football team, and Treylon Burks, Arkansas wide receiver. Now, based on fit and where they landed, if to answer your question, who do I think will be the best on the field next year? I'm going to go Treylon Burks, actually. I think that he has the, you know, a lot of these, there's two big bodied receivers in this run of receivers, and it's Drake London and it's Treylon Burks. problem with Drake London, in my opinion, is he's really skinny. He's 6'5", but he's thin. So I think there might be some adjustment period for him in the NFL. Meanwhile, Treylon Burks is measuring in at like 6'3", 230 pounds, something like that. He is a man already. He's coming into an established offense and with clearly a starting role right off the bat. So if I was to name someone who's going to have the most instant impact out of these receivers, it would be Treylon Burks. Now, I will say they're all kind of in the same grouping. It just kind of depends on what your favorite flavor of ice cream is. But I, even though they overdraft him, and again, we talked about value, I love Jahan Dotson. I love him. I thought he would be a late first, early second pick. So not sure about the value here, but my God, like I love that dude's got the best hands in the draft. He is small, but he's not afraid to go over the middle. He's not like a Will Fuller. He can do Will Fuller things, but he's not one of those scared small guys. So if I was going to take like a long shot, one that could become the best one in this draft, I would go with Dotson. Just, you know, but again, they're all kind of great. Who do you like the best out of these six?
I think Williams is the best player. Now he's coming off the injury, but those injuries are not what they used to be. So they're not as devastating.
He'll be on the PUP for 6 weeks, probably.
Yeah. So I don't even think it was debatable. I think the kid, he was at Ohio State because he's a great athlete, transferred to Bama for whatever reason. And then once he got on the field, he was all world explosive. If he doesn't get hurt in that national championship game, who knows what happens? Maybe Alabama wins that game. Maybe they don't.
Probably.
But he is a true difference maker. He was, in my opinion, the best. My favorite probably, though, was Olave from Ohio State. I love that kid. Mm-hmm. Not the biggest dude, but he's not small. And, you know, talk about hands. That dude's got great hands. His all the catches he can make, his midair body adjustment, body control, talk about that kind of stuff a lot.
OBJ type.
Yeah, I mean, or even like a Gallup from Dallas. Like Gallup has really good body control in the air.
Gallup's like 6'2", 6'3", though.
Yeah, he's a way bigger dude. Yeah. I'm just talking about like body control in the air. Mm-hmm. You know, that's really what makes Gallup, you know, what makes him a starting receiver in the league. That's kind of the same thing that I thought about Olave. But, yeah, that's – I don't know, fit, and like you said, all the schemes of –
It's hard to say.
It's hard to say. I don't think that
– There's no homeboy that went to the Bengals last year. What's his name, receiver?
Oh, Chase Young?
Yeah, Jamar Chase.
Jamar Chase.
There's no Jamar Chase. So there is in this class, there is no like, oh my God, that dude is the shit. It's a lot of the same, and you know.
And you know, it's funny because on the I Mean It podcast, I did break down the numbers, and you really shouldn't draft receivers in the first round at all if you're looking for first team all pros, because as a percentage, they're one of the worst positions you could possibly draft and get a first team all pro, which just means that there's great value in other rounds. However, today we were watching, I can't remember what the show was, but they were breaking down kind of the financial impact of drafting a receiver in the first round. And without having that fifth year option, you know, financially, it's just really starting to make not a lot of sense to draft receivers late, because if they're good, I mean, AJ Brown just got $100 million, like, they're making such crazy money at this point. If you don't get the fifth year to be able to, you know, financially keep them affordable and controllable for 5 years, man, you're just turning them over every 4 years, which, you know, that's life in the NFL. But I'm just saying, I do understand it from that perspective. However, you really just got to weigh your options, because you're not – all these guys that got drafted, I guarantee you one of these dudes is going to be a
– All pro.
Maybe. And the rest of them are just going to be Jags at best, and probably half of them are going to be out of the league in 3 years. So that's just how the NFL works. But I like those two guys. I like those two guys.
All right. What else you like? What else stands out here in the first round?
Well, it's time. It is time to get to the only quarterback selection in the first round. And if you boys and girls have been watching the I Mean It podcast, you know that I've already broken this player down and told you why you couldn't draft him in the first round. You shouldn't draft him in the first round. But yet, he got drafted in the first round, and he was the only one of these quarterbacks that did. Oh, it was a terrible selection. And the reason why, just quickly, Kenny Pickett went to the Pittsburgh Steelers at 20. He's the second quarterback the second quarterback to ever in the history of the NFL get drafted in the first round with under 9-inch hands. The only other one to be drafted was Michael Vick, who was one of the greatest athletes we've ever seen coming in this league. And again, if you watch the podcast, you know I broke his numbers down statistically.
So you're saying he's Michael Vick?
No. Statistically, Michael Vick was a below-average quarterback for his NFL career. Mm. And he was literally the most gifted athlete I had ever seen at the position until Lamar Jackson obviously was born or whatever. So that dude being that special, and he had a cannon for an arm. He didn't always know where it was going, but it was a fucking cannon.
Missile.
He was below average. Kenny Pickett is not special in any way. He's got tiny hands.
Sir,
and
his mother might be listening. My God. Have some respect.
His mom is doing my dishes right now. All right, that's what she's doing.
hola, Miss Pickett. Who said that?
Anyway, now, no disrespect to the kids, sir. We're just joking around. But as a prospect,
you don't like him.
He's got tiny hands, and he scored a 16 on his 1-8, which means he's stupid.
And how about that press conference with Mike Tomlin? Did you like that when the owner – was that the owner or the GM? No, it was the GM. The GM's out there talking about how great this pick was, and fucking Tomlin's up there looking like he's in the fourth quarter of a game. He's losing by 20, just trying to put on that I'm the CEO, I'm the leader, they can't see me, you know, hurting or looking like I don't go along with this. But man, Tomlin's been coached for like 20 years. When you see someone in the public for that long, you get a read on their emotions, and you can just tell he ain't fucking digging this pick.
No, there's no fucking way he signed off on this pick. And again, that you have to have some, if you're going to be an outlier in height, in hand size, in a Wonderlic score, you have to have something outstanding, right, to compensate for that outlier to even give you a chance to be successful in the NFL. He's got two outliers. His hands are tiny, and he's stupid. And yet, he has nothing special to help him. He doesn't have a special arm. He's not a special athlete. He was literally a bum at Pitt, a bum, for 4 years. In his fifth year, he was a first-team All-American, had a great year. Mm-hmm. It took him 4 years of playing, and in a fifth year, in a down year in the ACC, by the way, to make an All-American. This kid has bust written all over him, and the fact that one of the best franchises in the NFL took him the first round is still blowing my fucking mind. I got to be honest.
Yeah, guys, look, I say it every time I do a video. If you're not following, subscribe to the Revolution Network, you have to, because you're not going to get anybody else in this realm of draft breakdowns that's going to come out and say that a player is stupid and has tiny hands and should but then also back it up with the data and lay it out for you. So if you're not, you got to subscribe to get, I mean, I know we joke around a lot. We dick around a lot, but we do take our jobs seriously. We make it entertaining, but it's for a purpose. And I haven't heard anybody else come out and say the things that you said. And these are people getting paid millions of dollars to go on TV and actually do this shit. But for whatever reason, they're throttled. They're not allowed to tell you the truth, but that's what you're here for. You're here for the truth, not to make you feel good. And what Bo Sievers just told you is the absolute truth. And yeah.
Well, I mean, if you're a Browns or a Ravens fan, it made you feel good.
Yeah, I'm sure they're feeling real good today. Well, Baker's not, but you know, that's a different story.
Yeah. Well, that was your boy, not mine. I never liked him either.
Yeah, we're not going to rehash that. What else you got?
That's really all I had, man, for the first round, unless you got anything else.
Oh, my God. I've got plenty more. I can go through them real quickly. Quay Walker, the Packers took him, linebacker out of Georgia, with the 22nd pick. He, of course, was rated behind N'Kobe Dean, the other linebacker from Georgia. Now, if you've been listening to me on some of my shows and breakdowns, you would have already known that
what's the name of your show?
Oh, I'm sorry, it is the Football and Freedom Show. Or you know, some things that I post out and whatnot, but like, not that it was predictive, but a lot of people had that watched the tape and understood, and again, this is a size thing, kind of like what you're talking about with Pickett.
She said
there's not a lot of first round linebackers that have the size of N'Kobe Dean. He's tiny. And it's not that, it's not the fact that he's short, because he measures in at 5'11". We've had plenty of 5'11" fantastic linebackers. It's, but when you think of the 5'11" linebackers, they're fucking rocked up. Like, they're just beefed up.
Is he inside linebacker?
Yeah, he's MLB.
Well, that is another position, like, on that breakdown of Amin, that was a terrible value selection in the first round. Terrible. You've had one, Luke Kuechly, and that's it. It's been an all first team all pro in the entire time that I did the data run. Every other one has been like second or third round and on. Terrible value.
Yeah, I mean, and even with that said, like, the fact that he's 5'11" and weighs in, his playing weight's like 220 pounds.
Oh.
I mean, I know the NFL's changing and whatnot, but that's – anyways, the point being that a lot of people that really followed this draft kind of expected that some of the other linebackers would get picked ahead of Dean, and Dean's still available here in day two, and we'll see how far he falls. So that kind of stood out to me. Baltimore, here's another one I wrote down. What does Baltimore do every year? They just sit there. It's not that they don't move, but they don't move without purpose or reason. And what they do in this draft, well, they sat there at number 14 and had Kyle Hamilton, who I think is going to be the defensive rookie of the year, fall to them when he was a top 3-5 prospect on most people's boards, talent-wise. Now, I know people don't want to draft safeties that high, and the value isn't necessarily there. But again, smart teams like Baltimore let that value fall to them in the perfect place. They got him at 14, and then they actually traded up, I believe. This doesn't say anything about – we were pretty drunk by pick 25, so it's, my memory's a little jostled. But I think they traded up, and what they get? Tyler Linderbaum, who's going to be an all-pro center for the next, you know, 10 years once he gets settled in. Like, this is what Baltimore does, so I wanted to kind of point that out. And we got to talk about the Cowboys pick. I mean, we just have to. Like, Tyler Smith went one pick ahead of they're both named Tyler. That's weird. Tyler Linderbaum for the who went to Baltimore. So Tyler Smith is a giant, small school prospect who has a holding problem. Does that sound like a 24th overall pick to you, Bo Cephas?
I think they took a guy like that in the second or third round named Connor Williams.
No, he was Texas. That wasn't small school. I mean, how about Larry Allen?
Y'all don't think.
How about Larry Allen, Sonoma State? I believe that was second, third round.
Yeah.
But that was second or third round.
And he also bench pressed 700 pounds.
I don't know what Tyler Smith's bench press was, but I bet it wasn't 700. I bet it wasn't 700. Bottom line, you know, this is and how about Jerry coming out showing the draft board at the press conference?
Hey, if you some bitches don't think that we had both of them ranked ahead, I'll show you. Here it is.
Put that down, Jerry. What the fuck are you doing? Like, someone needs a screenshot. Jerry literally flashed to the media their big board. I don't know if it was just a first round big board. I would love to see that snapshot and blown up so we can actually see it. And get a kick out of who they had in there, because he said 16, right? They had him at 16. I know teams do things different, but having a small school offensive tackle in an offensive tackle rich draft at 16, well, that's putting your big balls on the table, and Jerry's not opposed to doing that. He puts his big balls in a lot of places, as we heard in the offseason, that cost him a lot of money. But yeah, that's a call your shot pick. And again, like I said before, who are we to say? Like, if he becomes Pro Bowl level, I mean, they fucking nailed it. But it just, I don't understand why teams go so, and we'll talk about one in New England here in a minute, but like, why do teams go so far to prove they're the smartest people in the room in the draft? Why? You don't have to. You could have traded back and got that kid in the late first. New England could have traded back into the fucking late second and got the guy they got in the first round. Why?
Yeah, I think that's the bigger thing. Like, if that's your kid and he really is that high on your board, which Jerry showed us all he really was, that's fine if that's your advice. And let me just say this. Will McClay, who heads up their personnel department, does one of the best jobs in the NFL. And I know Cowboys fans, you people bitch, moan, and complain about fucking just about everything, but I think I showed you the other day, since 2010, the Cowboys have drafted
more all pro, not just first team, but all pro selections than any other team. San Francisco's like second with 7. The Cowboys had 8. There wasn't another team that had more than 4. And there was like 5 of them or whatever with that. So the Cowboys are literally kicking ass for the last decade plus at drafting. So if you're going to come at Will McClay, you better have your shit together, because the dude's pretty fucking good and his department's pretty fucking good at what they do.
That's even with drafting Taco.
That, I mean, Taco and Van Der Esch, let's be honest. Oh, my God. But I guess my only pushback on it is just what you said. You know, like, I mean, they know. Like, they know if they have him at 16, they know nobody else had him at 16. They could have traded back. He was still going to be there. And if you get your high, if you get your 16th ranked dude at 32 or wherever they could have fallen back to, oh, my God, you're kicking ass. And especially if you're right about the dude, then you're murdering
things. And this was, they said, like one of the record-breaking trade-up, trade-downs in the back half of this draft. So they were willing partners to trade. And whatever, they called their shot. They put the balls on the table. Nothing talked about New England. They took Cole Strange, a center/guard that I actually like out of Chattanooga. Liked him a lot in the third round. He was going to be one of my targets in the third round. They took him.
Isn't that where T.O. went to school?
No. T.O. went to, oh, my God, why did you put me on a spot like that?
Wasn't Chattanooga?
It was like, I think it was a small Tennessee school, but it wasn't Chattanooga.
How many goddamn small Tennessee schools are there?
I mean, that is a scholarly state, sir. you can't put enough schools in Tennessee to fit all the smart people. No, but like, I guess we already covered it. Like, why do that? I just don't get it. Belichick, he likes to do things like this. He likes to claim that he's the smartest person in the world. And I'll show you. I'll take a third round guard in the first round, and he'll be an all pro. Who knows? Maybe he will. We'll see. Let's see. I don't have anything else written down necessarily that to go over with the first round. Devontae Wyatt, the defensive tackle that the Packers took. The Packers kind of killed it, even though they didn't help the quarterback. And we'll see how OAA Ron thinks about that. But as far as just value and what they did, I love Devontae Wyatt out of Georgia. I think he's going to be better than Jordan Davis, have a better career. He's more of that gap penetrating three tech defensive tackle. And Jordan Davis is more of just your big giant man who's going to destroy offensive linemen for about 20 plays a game. So we'll see how that works out. You got anything else in the first round that stands out to you that you wanted to hit?
Not really. I think the Jordan Davis pick was a bad pick by Philly, and they traded up to get him. And you just can't give up those kind of assets for a dude that will. And again, even if he's as great as they hope that he is, you and I looked up the numbers, or we were having a conversation. I looked up the numbers. He's going to play about 40% of the snaps.
Yeah, period. At most.
So now he can be great for 40% of the snaps, and that's great.
And I think he will be. His tape shows you he will be about 30%. For about 80% of his 100% snaps that he plays, which is about 30% of the game. So 80% of the 100 he plays of the 30 in the game, he's going to fucking kill it, man. He's going to be great.
Oh, studies show 30% of the time it works every time. Some fucking Panther perfume. Yeah, I don't know. It's just too much to give up for that kind of dude. And again, the podcast I did showing, if you don't take those big fat fatties on defense in the top 10, they generally either turn out to be Jags or just nothings. So basically they traded up for a guy that's probably going to be a nothing or a Jag at best. And they gave up asses to do it. Didn't care for that pick, but I hate the Eagles, so I don't give a fuck.
Go fly, Eagles, fly.
All right, man. Looking forward to the second and third tonight?
Second and third.
Second and third on day 2 of the draft. Looking ahead. Okay. BPA that you got on your board still left, and then who can still really get some help here, and why?
Well, for draft dorks like me, there's a fucking list of 150 players that I like.
We ain't got that kind of
time. I know we don't. So, obviously, Malik Willis, quarterback that everybody thought would be the first quarterback taken in the first round, he's still available. That'll probably be a mistake. Actually, you know what? Second round, it won't be a mistake. This is where you take this player. So, he'll come in and be a project for somebody, and that's exactly what he should be. Breece Hall, running back out of Iowa State. That kid, depending on where he lands, and it could be the first pick in the second round to Tampa Bay, that kid's going to come in and be a difference maker day one. David Ajabo, this was a top 10 defensive end talent out of Michigan. Obviously, he tore his Achilles in the combine. So he's still available in the second round. We'll see how far he falls. Boye Mafe, another outside linebacker, defensive end type prospect. He's one of this is one of those bend guys that I, you know, you can't teach bend. It's one of those things that you either have that bend or you don't. And Boye Mafe has it. Really like that prospect. Defensive tackle that I love, maybe the most in this draft, is still available. It's Travis Jones out of UConn. He is a mountain of a man, like Jordan Davis, not quite that big, but close. But he don't get tired, and he pushes the pocket, and he gap penetrates, even though he's 335 pounds. So I love that prospect. Let's see. Oh, Andrew Booth. This is a guy that should have gone in the top 15, cornerback out of Clemson. I mentioned it to you last night as he was kind of starting to slide. There were some red flag rumors on this guy. This happens every year. There's a player that gets medical red flagged. I don't know if it's medical or if it's off the field. Who knows? We don't know these things until later. But it'll be interesting to see how far he falls, because he should have been gone a long time ago. And if he makes it halfway through the top of the second round, look out. There could be something that all the teams know that we won't find out till later. But that is absolutely a first-round type prospect on the field. That's all I got for players to watch in the second and third round tonight.
Well, I mean, there's really not much else that I like talking about than gap penetration. That's one of my favorite subjects.
You were definitely watching a video about that earlier, right?
Like, for like about 5 or 7 minutes, and I lost interest after that.
Yeah, I heard.
I think the running back from Iowa State, Hall, I think that's a great pick for 33 for Tampa Bay. If you think about the Buccaneers and what they are, what they're doing, they're a veteran team. Obviously, with the GOAT at quarterback, they're all in on this however long Tommy's going to be here. They got to get a difference maker right now. No position has a bigger impact in their first year as a rookie than running back can have on an offense. We've seen plenty of rookies come in, be offensive player of the year, rookie of the year, dynamic. I mean, just, you know, total game changers for about a year or two. That's who could actually help you. You know, rookie wide receivers generally don't make a huge impact. I mean, obviously with Ja'Marr Chase, it can happen, but those two also had a relationship prior to, and the dude is really special. So add those two together and you get something like that. But for the most part, they don't help. Some pass rusher can obviously help you, but they're pretty stacked on defense already. So love the running back pick there. And I don't know how you mentioned this with Malik Willis sitting there. If you're the Vikings at 34, or you've got, I think here's my two things. If you're the Vikings at 34 or Seattle, you got 40 and 41. Mm-hmm. So how, if you're Seattle, you don't package 40 and 41 up and go to 33, wherever you think you got to go. Yeah. And take Malik Willis, or if you're the Vikings and he's sitting there and you're standing at 34 and you don't take Malik Willis, I think you're making a mistake. And again, I don't love the kid as a prospect, but you're in the second round now. All fucking bets are off. You're gonna get great value if he's just a starter at all, because historically, second round quarterbacks and later, they're barely even starters in the NFL. So if this kid is even a starter, you're knocking it out of the fucking park. So you got to go draft your quarterback, man. You just have to.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think he's going to come off really quick here in day two, and Seattle would be smart. But you know, you got to have a trade partner. You can't just call it and say, "Hey, I'm coming up here. Deal with it. He's mine." So yeah, like if Minnesota wants him, then they're gonna. I mean,
they'd have to go to Tampa
unless they can go to Tampa. But Tampa Bay already traded down out of the first. I don't know how much they want to keep doing that, but you're right. You know, that's. Lots of good players left here in day two of the draft. There's going to be lots of good players left in day three. That is where you build your team. That is how you build the roster so that you can get over that hump of winning the Super Bowl. I mean, it starts right here in April.
Starts right here. All right. What also starts right here is you guys winning money with us, FGH. We do it every single year. We put out the best picks in the industry. We're proven winners year after year after year. It's what we do. So please come sign up for a subscription this fall. College, NFL, buy them both. Buy them separately. Try us out for a week. Try us out for a month. Or if you're a client, you know, you just buy the yearly package. You save the money. It's a no fucking brainer. It's what we do. We win you money. We make you money. Guaranteed. You follow our program that my buddy does a very good job of every year.
on our preseason podcast, laying out and telling you exactly how and when to invest your money. And this year, also to our clients coming, we are going to be putting out our over-under total win picks that we put in Vegas. So we will send you those picks as we get into town and make those bets so you get the official numbers. And we will tell you which teams to go over, which teams to go under. What we went 10-3-1 last year. 9-4-1.
Yeah, 9-4-1.
So we bet 14 teams. We went 9-4-1 on those teams.
Only because we got a bad number with Houston.
That was our push. It should have been fucking 10-4. It should have been 10-4. We did take the push there. God damn you, Jacksonville. That's what I'll have to say about that.
That's right. They beat them twice, right?
They beat them twice. Motherfuckers. All right. That's about all I got.
Steven Tyler?
Yeah. It's about that time.
Is it Steven Tyler time?
I think so.
I mean, this is our unnatural format. So, I mean, you know, I don't even know how we come out of this without our normal spiel. Drink all the beer, have all the fun.
Yeah, sure.
Let's just do that.
All right, Steven Tyler, take us out, baby.